I would like to start with a few words from Scott Kelly, who could not come, but he registered this message.
Well, I do believe the space station is an example of how we can work cooperatively in space in an international environment with our international partners. I do think it's one of the great things about, if not the greatest thing about the International Space Station, is we did something that is incredibly challenging and difficult, quite possibly the most challenging thing we've ever done, building this million-pound space station. And we did it as an international partnership. You know, I loved spending time in space with all my crew members, but when you spend time in space with people from other cultures, people that came from different places with different, different habits, different beliefs, it makes the experience much more enriching and much more rewarding. So, just to summarize, I think the greatest thing about the space station is that it's an international space station.
The timing of IAC is perfect for this, as it turns out, because it was on the 20th of November, 1998, that the very first module of the International Space Station was launched. That was the Zarya module. And just less than a month after that, on the 4th of December, 1998, the Unity Node 1 module was launched with Endeavour. And in fact, here you see the very moment where Bob Cabana and Sergei Krikalev were about to enter Unity for the very first time on December 10th, 1998. And then they had assembled the two modules together on that mission and released ISS, as it now was, with these two modules from Endeavour on December 13th. So it's incredible to imagine. I say this as somebody who teaches undergraduate students, to think that their entire lives this has been functioning, and that there have been people there since November 2nd, 2000, so we'll have another anniversary to celebrate in just a couple of years, the continuous habitation of the International Space Station. In any case, it obviously has developed quite dramatically since then, right now comprising well over a dozen modules. This is a space station where planning began for it in 1982, originally as Space Station Freedom, originally just a U.S. project, but then obviously developed within just a relatively short period of time into a fully international project involving, obviously now, the European Space Agency, the Japanese Space Agency, the Canadian Space Agency, and Roscosmos, as well as a variety of other nations that contributed in other ways. There have been 233 visitors to ISS, which is actually not that far off of half of all the humans that have ever been to space. It's really a remarkable sight of human activity in this new context. 1,000 cubic meters of habitable space. I don't mean to overwhelm you with numbers, but I just think this is amazing. So anyway, with all of that in mind, we can now start with our first group of panelists, and I'll turn this back.
Just a few words of who you are.
Oh, excuse me. My name is Justin Walsh, and I am an archaeologist, so that might seem like it's a little odd standing here in front of you talking about this, but together with one of our panelists in the second group, Dr. Alice Gorman, whom you'll see shortly, we are actually initiating the first archaeological study of a human habitation site in space, and ISS is our site. And if you're interested in that, I would encourage you to check out our website, which is at issarchaeology.org, or follow us on Twitter at issarchaeology. So thanks for the plug, Jean-Francois. And now we can continue.
And by the way, Julie has worked a PhD, which looks at how space policy, space science, and space industry are interlinked and making the story of human spaceflight. And she's now teaching sociology in St. Petersburg. And I am an ESA astronaut. I think I have the record of duration of active status. I've been selected in 85. So I've been an astronaut for 33 years. And I work also at Novespace, which is the company in Europe making zero-G flight. I call now for the first roundtable Nicolas Chamoussi, the head of space systems at Airbus. Jean-Jacques Dordain, who is one of the co-founders of the ISS, and Bernard Foin, director of the International Lunar Exploration Working Group, and Koichi Wakata, my classmate, group 14 of NASA astronaut, who flew several times on board the ISS and who is now director general of human spaceflight at JAXA and vice president. After 10 years of successful international cooperation since the 10th anniversary that we celebrated in Paris 10 years ago, how do you see this success of international cooperation influence, impact the future of human spaceflight on future human spaceflight programs, including the Gateway? So I would like to give the floor first to Jean-Jacques, because he has been the co-founder of ISS, and you can tell us how you see this cooperation going.
When this is a success, there are many fathers, and unfortunately, when it's a failure, there is much less fathers. So this is just a way to say that yes, ISS is a success, and because the number of fathers are is very large. I think that I shall quote Mike Griffin, one of my colleagues of NASA administrator when I was director general. Mike Griffin said that the partnership of the space station will last much longer than the hardware. And that is certainly the way we should look at the ISS. ISS is one important milestone in international cooperation in space. And the partnership is the most important asset. Obviously, there is a lot of other results, but that will stay, in my view, forever, because this partnership has been built through a lot of problems and a lot of catastrophes. And this is thanks to the partnership that we could overcome these difficult periods, because today we are speaking of the success, but I can report that we have gone through a lot of difficult moments. But if we could overcome that, it was thanks to the partnership and international cooperation. And that will stay forever. And this is the reason why the future will be built around more and more cooperation. That it's, I hope so, at least, that the partnership will not stay as it is. This is an open partnership, and that other partners will come in any future project. And I shall end by that, because that is always what I said when I was in charge. Cooperation is difficult. It's always easier not to cooperate. And so when we speak of cooperation, it looks always very beautiful. But I have the experience of international cooperation. That this is for sure, and I can report that this is very, very difficult. But this is the most sustainable path. Competition is interesting, but as soon as you know the winner, it stops. And this is the reason why cooperation is the sustainable path. So what I wish, what I praise my young colleagues and successors is to work for cooperation, but to have an open cooperation, open to any partner, ready to share the same values and the same objectives.
Thank you, Jean-Jacques. Koichi,
yes.
Can you tell us your views?
Yes, I totally agree with Jean-Jacques. Yeah, I think people say that if you want to get there very quick, do it alone. And if you're going to go further or longer, do it together. I think ISS is a proof of this, the outcome of the international cooperation. We were able to survive difficulty, as Jean-Jacques said, with the difficulty of the transportation system, space shuttle accident. And also we had encountered launching vehicle failure or cargo ship failure. But because of the international partnership, we were able to survive as a system of the International Space Station. And this framework of international intergovernmental agreement of the space station, that's the basis of future exploration, I believe. It takes a long time to settle down or agree on those big framework of work, especially with having 15 countries, and for future exploration, we may be having more countries. So this establishment of intergovernmental agreement could be as a hassle. So I think we can base the what we have already established as a framework to cooperate. And we can expand that to different countries. And but I think it's important to have a dissimilar redundancy like we have on the space station, or space suit, or launching system, cargo supply vehicles, even CO2 removal capabilities. By having this redundancy, dissimilar redundancy, we will be able to survive even if we encounter issues. So those are the lessons that we learned, I believe. And as Jean-Jacques said, I believe this partnership has been working great on the space station.
You know, here we have two commanders of spaceship that are in this room. Pam Miroy, who has commanded the space shuttle, Koichi, who has commanded the ISS. And I would like to ask you, Koichi, is it easier to command the ISS or to command the Directorate of Human Spaceflight at JAXA?
That's a good question.
Short answer.
Short answer, because I see my former bosses here, so I have to be very polite. Yes, I think it's much more challenging to command the Directorate of Human Spaceflight.
In a good way. Nicolas he was a manager of the ATV. The ATV was the automated transfer vehicle, the European version automatic cargo ship, 21 tons, docking autonomously to the ISS to resupply the US segment by docking to the Russian segment. And we celebrated the 10 years this year. So tell us your view.
Few remarks. First, I fully subscribe to what Jean-Jacques I need to tell you, this guy has been my teacher. Fluid mechanics. I've not used it at all, but you are my teacher. Because there's no fluid in space, so it's almost no fluid. Now, something that strikes me, also especially today, is the capability that, as both of you said, to work in cooperation in space during things which are absolutely amazing. And when it comes to bring people together in a single room in Northern Germany, we still are facing difficulties to bring people for single down-to-earth passport and visa issues, which I think it tells a lot of what the cooperation in ISS meant and what has been achieved. Now, we'd like to give you also one view from industry, the modest industry side, which I represent. Talked about cooperation, just to tell you about industrial cooperation. With ATV, we have cooperated with Energia. And this was a company which did not exist officially when we started the cooperation. It was not even registered on the maps. And we are here 20 years later. These are people we work together. These are people we would be working together. And I think in terms of what it means in the evolution of the industrial structure of this program is extremely important. Now, what it means for the future, I don't know. I'm speaking of the control of those who know about what will be LOPG and whatever the new name will be maybe in the future. What I understand, it will be smaller, but it will be maybe with a different geopolitical structure. Maybe not exactly the same participants, maybe not exactly the same nations. Maybe we will see in this future architecture countries which were not active directly in the ISS, which might pop up, I don't know, whoever. And some who were in the ISS, which might not play exactly the same role as what was the role of their country in the ISS. So I think we have the basis of having learned both on the government-to-government, industry-to-industry relationship. We need to capitalize on this, but it will not be the same, probably. And also the role of industry might be probably a bit different. We were, and we are still basically hardware supplier, development supplier to the nations, to the agencies. Probably in the future, we have already started to do it. For those who know about Bartolomeo, so what Airbus is doing, now we position ourselves with the support of the agency in a new role, which will not be necessarily only hardware supplier. We endeavor to be more service suppliers, service providers to the governments, to the nation, to the agencies. And I think this is a significant role. We can only do it because we have learned over the years, sometimes in a hard way, how to cooperate and how to contribute to these programs.
Thank you, Nicolas. Now, Bernard. Bernard Foy, director of the International Lunar Exploration Working Group.
So, in my career, I just have a few images to give some background. In my career, I worked with two international platforms that have really completely influenced my work. So actually, I'm an astrophysicist. I worked on sounding rockets, and I worked on experiments that were flown on Space Lab. And then I was joining ESA for some visit, and at this time, I worked on trying to put some instrument on board the space station. So this started in 1990, and actually Jean-Jacques was actually at the time the head of this Columbus department trying to put science on the space station, and that's how actually I got my first job at ESA. I've got my first job at ESA with ISS. And I can say I had two mistresses in my life, don't tell my wife, the International Space Station and the Moon. And on the International Space Station, that's how I started. So we wanted to put telescopes, and then there was a call for Columbus precursor mission, because we said, okay, we are not going to have it launched in 1992, so we'll have a bit of time to prepare. So I was in the community, we proposed experiment to put telescope, to put also life science experiment, to put samples of organics, and actually this has materialized with a series of experiment on the precursor capsule, like a biopan, photon, and on EXPOSE. And so we brought some of this experiment on board, so they are now, they have been flying, we recovered, we found that some life can survive in space. So, and actually also at home, we say that we have some module, we can do a lot of experiments, this is what we use to train the astronaut, but also we use that to bring some of the youngsters, the artists, that can also have the experience of free-floating in our Columbus module. Sometimes we organize even cultural events there at STEC. Now, my other mistress is the Moon, and that's another very interesting platform. It's a really natural satellite of the Earth. That's a natural platform for international endeavor. So we started by building a moon robotic floating village around the moon. And I was lucky that I was then hired as a lunar scientist to take care of smart ones. But the Japanese also had their mission, the Chinese, the Indian, the US. And we started to build really a village, a community of people working together, scientists, engineers. But that's not enough. We have to go to the next step to expand this frame, also building on what we have done on the International Space Station. So going together around the moon, and we go with the humans, and also going together on the surface of the moon. And the vision is that's true to be inclusive of new countries that share the same values, build on the experience of the ISS, but also bring on some lessons of the ISS, trying to find a platform where you can have also independent program, and the moon is a great platform for that because you don't have to ask your neighbor where to land. The space station or gateway is a bit different because it's more like a ship and a spaceship. So you have a captain, you have safety issues. So you have to be consistent if you dock there, not to have a danger. The moon is a natural platform where you can have more independent endeavors, but it's important that not only on the technical side, but on the human, on the international side, we coordinate and we really work as villagers together to build it to the benefit of humankind.
Bernard, how many member states, nations involved in this working group as of today?
International Lunar Working Group, so we have the 22 countries.
More or less than ISS?
Yes, more than ISS, because we have all the 22 countries of ESA, but we have also China, Japan, Russia, Ukraine, India, and also some emerging countries have representatives there. Now it's partly agency, but also we have tried to open it to the commercial world. So we have also industry representatives, we have also academia, And all of you can also be a lunar explorer and contribute. So we have activities like you have seen here, where we try also to serve all the community, over age, over disciplines, over continents.
Thank you, Bernard. Now the floor is yours, so you have 10 minutes to ask questions to our panelists.
Thank you so much for the session. I have heard the word international cooperation from Monday and all the sessions, but I just would like to understand exactly what you mean by, because it's a bit too abstract to refer to international cooperation. So if anybody would like to just share a practical example of what international cooperation means to you, that would be great. Thank you.
I mean, I could start with a simple level and I'll let you the difficult level. The simple level is, for instance, if you develop a scientific mission, we acquire the data and we share them with the whole world. So we put them in archive and we try to have them used by everybody also in emerging countries. The next level, which is relatively simple, when you have a scientific experiment, you have teams that come from all countries and we can host them in our platform. Now, what is more difficult if you are building a ship together, like the International Space Station, then I'll let you to see how you handle that. So our international cooperation can come as a way of working together, but also ways of showing values of the peaceful cooperation, and also how the problem of how you can also use sensitive technologies and how you manage the legal frame for that. I'll leave that.
Maybe a very simple example. I was about to use down to Earth, but it's not the right way. Down to space example. I was program manager for ATV, so this resupply ship to the station, which would eventually dock to the aft part of the station. So it boils down to very simple things. You would dock to a Russian design module, and you have to make sure that once the thing will be docking, it will work. Just as simply. Even mechanically, you have connectors. You just need to make sure that the connectors will click one in each other, just as if you plug in your wall plug. That's as simple as this. Now, this is the easy part, the mechanical part, the electrical part. Now, just to make sure that the whole thing works, that when the crew commands something, then it goes all the way down to the station, I mean, speaking of the control of the two astronauts or three astronauts in the room, that it works exactly this way. Keep in mind that the Russian part, the docking part where we would eventually dock, was developed in a place, as I said before, which was not even known, which not even recognized a few years before we started the program. And so we had to bring ATV simulators to Energia in Korolev City, which a couple of years before would not even have been feasible. We would not even have thought about it. So these are extremely down to space things that you have to do just to cooperate, just to make the system work.
Okay, I think that it's a very wide question, but myself, I have some experience of international cooperation, but of project-driven cooperation. And the fact that this is project-driven cooperation makes a big difference, because when you are cooperating on a project, you have the same objective, and that this is the first important condition. If you have not the same objective, very difficult to cooperate. So we decide to land on a comet, that, and you have no choice. The comet will not wait for your cooperation. So we are all working with the same objective. Number two, we share the resources, meaning that each partner is bringing a part of the resources, so you have to agree on who is bringing which resources. Number three, and that this is maybe the most difficult, you build up trust among the partners, and you cannot buy trust. You demonstrate trust, you build up trust, and trust is coming from the cooperation among the people. The people is, at the end, the most important part of any cooperation, because it's always what I said. I was not negotiating when I was the ESA Director General. The negotiation between ESA and NASA was a discussion between Mike Griffin and me, between Charlie Bolden and me. And at the end, it's the relationship among people and the trust among people, which is very important. And after that, you share the success.
Now, somewhere, yes, Koichi, because you know international cooperation, including in space.
That's right. Yeah, good question. I think all my panelists already covered important items, and if I could add something more like a philosophical, in a sense, and I think international cooperation is something that by sharing the same goal and the value and work together, we can have bigger than each individual's outcome as a group, actually. And by having the international cooperation, for example, Japan still does not have a capability to launch humans to space. But by participating in the International Space Station with a power supply vehicle, which is actually on board the space station right now, HTV number 7, and with the Kibo laboratory, and we were able to contribute to the program. So not everybody has to do the same thing, but by sharing the responsibility in a big system, we can enrich the outcome as a whole. And I think this is important because by cooperating together, we will be able to share the outcomes. And this is, I think, will lead to sustainable growth in humanity and the human presence in space. So I think, of course, if you, some countries that have both money and technology can do it alone, but by having this activity together, it will enrich us as humanity. And that's, I think, is the most important goal in exploration. And again, as Joe Frasso said, I really enjoyed working with so many astronauts and cosmonauts from around the world, especially if you go there to space. As a Frenchman, I think, I love French food, but if you only have French food in space, it could be boring if you stay there for 2 months to 6 months. But we can share different foods from everybody. And then, actually, we have a really good Japanese food, really popular. So, yes, working together will enrich our food life also.
Thank you, Koichi. One remark from Jean-Jacques.
Yes, one remark which is important about cooperation for human spaceflight. I am certainly one of the older in that room, in this room. And I have known myself the race of the 60s. So you have to integrate the fact that during 10 years, United States and USSR at that time, they were racing to be the first in space, to be the first on the moon, to be the first, and so on. 10 years of competition, very hard competition. But after these 10 years, it was almost only cooperation. They have started to make Apollo Soyuz. Less than 6 years after the US flag on the moon. And after Apollo Soyuz, it was the Space Station Freedom, the International Space Station, and so on. And you have to realize that since 50 years now, United States and Russia now, they have not anymore a domestic human spaceflight program. Their human spaceflight is only in that partnership. So you, for me, this is certainly the best result. The two ones who were the biggest competitors during 10 years, they have become the two partners, the two partners, main partners, I would say, of this endeavor of the International Space Station. So that is something that you have. As a young woman, you have to integrate that.
Yeah, but okay, that was a great lesson from the past. But now when you ask the youngster, they say, okay, we are in a different world. So more challenges, more countries to involve, more discipline. So also we have to face the new challenges of today through human spaceflight as well.
Yes, no, but okay. Yes, the cooperation in the future will be more complex, but anyway, the world will be more complex and that. Since I am still a professor, it's what I am telling to my students. you have no choice but to be better than I have been myself, because the problems that you will have to solve are much more difficult than the ones I have solved myself. I have made the easy part. You will have to make the difficult part. So yes, the world will be more and more complex, and the problems will be more and more difficult.
More
opportunities, but that this is maybe something that I wish also, since I am an old guy, to deliver. I think that the cooperation will be with more and more partners. But to make this type of cooperation working, you have to introduce more and more flexibility into that partnership. And frankly speaking, I can say that that space station is much too big, because this is the reunification of two space stations. That space station is the reunification between Space Station Freedom and Mir 2. And by reunifying two space stations, it makes that big space station. And it's much too big, because the logistics is very heavy. And so what you have to introduce in future cooperation is much more flexibility, to have all the partners agreeing on the same values, the same global objectives, but after that, leaving each partner able to choose a subgroup of the partners to make one project or two projects, provided this is feeding the same values and the same global objectives.
Merci Jean-Jacques. Thank you, all panelists. Just one concrete example. Since the space station has been manned continuously 18 years, the only lifeboat for all crew is the Russian Soyuz, for all crew. That's the only one for the last 18 years. Thank you. Please stay seated. And now I give the floor to Justin for the next round table.